Okay, let's start with a definition. The first definition is that of a continuously differentiable function. Let f be a function from R to C in our case, our interest is into continuous and periodic functions. So these functions, this function in this definition is a continuous function and periodic. We say that f is continuously differentiable if f prime is continuous, there is another terminology to use in this case, and is the terminology of a smooth function or simply a C1 function. Okay, sometimes these functions are called smooth functions, but this terminology is used for some authors, but not in general, okay. Or C1 functions. As I remarked, it's a well-known fact that C1 functions are differentiable functions. And of course, continuous functions. The converse is not true in general. There are differentiable functions which are not smooth or continuously differentiable functions. Okay. An example is the function x squared sine of 1 over x. This is a, well, this if x is not 0 and 0 if x is 0. This is a differentiable function which is not a continuously differentiable function. Okay. Well, our interest in this kind of functions is other, so I don't give any example explicitly here. I want to define the concept of a piecewise continuously differentiable function. Let f as above we say that f is a piecewise continuously differentiable function if there are real numbers. Remember that in our case, since f is a periodic function, this period is one, and we are interested in this function only in the interval 0, 1. Okay, so the idea is that all our interests must be concentrated in that interval. That's the reason which this definition is given in the interval 0, 1. So it's a piecewise continuously differentiable function in that interval, the interval 0, 1, if there are numbers, real numbers, t sub 0, in this case t sub 0 is equal to 0 to the left part of the interval. T sub 1 and T sub 1 greater than T sub 0 and so on. T sub R, which is equal to 1, such that for each J, J from 0 to, in this case, from 1 to R, this function, the restricted function to the interval t sub I my, sub j minus 1 t sub j is continuously differentiable. It's important to note that the idea in this case is that we have a continuous function. Okay, this function must be continuous, so we have no discontinuities in the interval 0, 1, but in the points t sub 0, t sub 1, and t sub r, those points, one has a not only continuity of the function, but we have also that on these intervals, this restricted function is continuously differentiable. Okay, in all in the whole interval 0, 1, we have no this property of to be a smooth function, but in these intervals, sub-intervals, the function must be continuously differentiable. But continuity of the function is true because the function considered in this definition is a continuous function, okay? Well, as the first result, well, before this result, I want to say a remark. As a remark, before the result, remember that if S sub n, F sub n is a sequence of continuous functions, on in our case is on the interval 0, 1, converging uniformly to some function f, Then F is also continuous. This means that uniform convergence preserves the continuity of functions of the sequence of the elements in the sequence when one considers this convergence in a closed interval. Okay. In our particular case, the interval is this closed interval. So continuity is preserved when one considers a sequence of functions, of continuous functions, converging uniformly to some function f. Okay. So we first establish the following result. Let f be continuous and periodic and suppose that the Fourier coefficients of F is C sub k, which is C sub k of F, satisfy this condition. Condition is that the series of the Fourier coefficients from minus infinite to infinite is a convergent series. Then the Fourier series of F is this series. Remember that the Fourier series is actually the sequence of partial sums. This sequence is called the Fourier series, and its limit usually is also called the Fourier series of F. Okay. This series, the sequence of partial sums, converges uniformly to the function f. Okay. So, in particular, for every x in the real line, we have that f of x is equal to the Fourier series. Okay, the proof of this lemma is simple. Okay, just remember that the Weierstrass M test. Let me see if we have that test. I don't remember what is this test. Here we have the Baeyes-Strauss-M test. Okay, note that when one has a sequence of partial sums whose nth elements or kth elements, a sub k of x, can be bounded by some m sub k, and the series of the m sub k's is a convergent series, then the Baeyes-Strauss-M test implies that the sequence of partial sums converges uniformly to this function. Okay, so in this case, we can use the Baeyes-Strauss-M test because note that we have these partial sums and the coefficients or the n terms can be estimated by the norms of the Fourier coefficients. Okay. Note that C sub k is sub k of x, the norm of these terms is equal to the norm of C sub k. And this this series is a convergent series by hypothesis. So the Baeyes-Strauss-M test implies that this series, according to that test, this series converges uniformly to F. Okay. That is, we have that this function is equal to the, in this case, converges uniformly to this function, not to f, because in this case, note that f is not necessarily equal to this series, okay? What we have proved until now is that this series or this sequence converges uniformly to some function, but that function, the limit function, need not be equal to f. The idea here is to see that the limit function is the same function f, okay? But by the Baeyes-Strauss-M test, this series converges to some function uniformly to this function, which I am going to call g of x. And this function is, of course, the series from minus infinity to infinity, c sub k times c sub k of x. Okay, we have the convergence, the uniform convergence of this sequence to this function. Okay, this is the limit function. But now we know, let me see if we have this in this class. No. Okay, in this class, we have this proposition. Remember that when a sequence converges uniformly to some function f, then that sequence converges also in the L2 norm to the function f. Okay. So first, I have to use the previous remark, this remark. Now that all these functions, all these partial sums are continuous functions, okay? Because all the elements involved in this sum are continuous functions. Note that f sub n or s sub n, this s sub n of f, are continuous for each n. So that its limit function g is also continuous because of the remark. See the remark. Okay. So G is continuous. On the other hand, we know that the Fourier series of a continuous and periodic function is convergent in the L2 norm to the function f. Okay. This Fourier series, the Fourier series of F converges in the L2 norm to the function F. And why is this true? Well, remember, in the previous class, we proved this theory. That if we have a periodic function and Riemann integrable function in the interval 0, 1, then the Fourier series of f converges to f in the L2 norm. Note that here the function f considered is a continuous function. F is a continuous function, but it is also an integrable function, because any continuous function is also integrable. So we have a periodic and integrable function in the interval 0, 1. This result, the last theorem in the previous class, establishes that this function, or this, the Fourier series of this function f, must converges in the L2 norm to the function. That is the reason which I am assuming or saying this here. The Fourier series of the function f must converges to the in the L2 norm to the function, to that function, to the function f. Okay. But also converges in the L2 norm to the function g, because we have another property, this property, that if we have a uniform convergence, the L2 convergence is also true. Okay, so if the Fourier series converges in the L2 norm on the one side to the function f, and on the other side to the function g. Okay. So this function, we have L2 norm convergence of the Fourier series of F to F and G. This means that this norm must be equal to zero. The L2 norm of this difference is equal to zero. Why? Well, it's simple to see this, because one has F sub n minus F plus F minus G. Okay. This norm, not in this way, is minus and it is plus. So, okay, let me put in this way. This is equal, this norm is equal to the norm of F minus G, the L2 norm of F minus G. But this is less or equal than, in view of the triangle inequality, of this sum, the sum of these two norms. When one take n going to epsilon, when n goes to epsilon, to zero, so, to infinite, sorry, we have that this is zero. This limit is zero, because this norm goes to zero when n goes to infinite, and the same occurs in this case. Okay, so since this is greater or equal than zero, this norm must be equal to zero. Is that clear? Okay, since F and G Sorry. Since F and G are continuous, positive definiteness of the L2 norm implies that F minus G must be equal to zero. That is, F is of course equal to G, but G is the sum. And this finishes the proof. Okay. Are there any questions? Do you have a question? Okay, we have proof that this sequence. Okay. Yes.
Profe, ¿cómo está? Este.
Dime.
Tenía una pregunta, pero sobre la definición de continua diferenciable por partes.
Esta, ok.
Este, dice que, o sea, es continua diferenciable en cada intervalo, ¿verdad?
Sí.
Restringida a la función.
Continuamente diferenciable, sí. Así se le suele decir. Ajá.
Pero el intervalo es cerrado.
Sí.
Y eso es lo que no entendía. O sea, que solo es continua diferenciable en
claro,
ese intervalo o en 0, 1 o en todo 0, 1.
Lo que pasa es que acá tú te refieres a estos intervalos que son cerrados. A esto.
Sí, yo me refiero en qué pasa en los puntos.
En los extremos.
Ajá, sí.
Sí, bueno, en lo que se suele decir acá es que ella es continua. Bueno, la idea es que su derivada es continua en el interior, ¿no? Y en los extremos lo que ocurre es que lo más que uno puede hacer es tomar derivadas laterales. La misma definición de derivada, solamente que h tiende a cero por la derecha y tiende a cero por la izquierda. Eso es lo que uno hace. ¿Okay? Pero acá lo que ocurre es que esos límites por la izquierda y por la derecha de las derivadas, la función no tiene por qué ser derivable, no tiene por qué ser tal que su derivada, si es que existe, sea continua en los extremos. ¿Okay? O sea, lo que se tiene es que ella es derivable en el interior, en los extremos, los límites existen, pero los límites de las derivadas, quiero decir, los límites de la función existen porque la función es continua y además van a ser iguales, los límites laterales. ¿Okay? Entonces hay continuidad, hay derivabilidad en el interior de esos intervalos, okay, pero en los extremos, en los intervalos, de esos subintervalos, no tiene por qué haber derivabilidad. Okay. Y la derivada dentro de cada intervalo es continua, además. O sea,
sí,
puede
esa era mi
pasar,
pregunta porque
puede
como
pasar,
estaba
hay continuidad, hay continuidad, sí, pero en esos puntos quizás ni siquiera hay derivabilidad, ¿ok? Porque
pero,
en los extremos como tal no tiene por qué haber derivabilidad.
Y eso me confundía porque decía continua y diferencial restringida a los intervalos
Sí.
cerrados.
En los intervalos abiertos, o sea, lo que yo te decía es que cuando uno calcula, ¿verdad? En el intervalo cerrado, vamos a ponerlo de esta forma. Uno puede calcular una derivada en el extremo izquierdo, en el punto A. ¿Cuál sería la derivada en A? Bueno, la derivada en A, digamos, nuestra derivada, tal como uno la define usualmente, es una, se define en intervalos abiertos, ¿no? O en puntos que están en intervalos abiertos. Entonces, yo veo que tu pregunta va en la dirección de que este punto, este es un intervalo cerrado y además estoy considerando el extremo izquierdo, ¿no? O el extremo derecho del intervalo cerrado. ¿Qué pasa en esos puntos? Si ahí yo no puedo definir la derivada, sí la puedo definir, solo que vamos a hacer algo así. Va a ser A más H menos F de A sobre H. Y aquí el límite, si estoy en A, tengo que ir por la derecha. Entonces el límite cuando H tiende a cero por la derecha. ¿Okay? Esa sería la derivada lateral. Uno puede definir derivadas laterales también. Algo similar ocurre con B cuando uno toma límite cuando H tiende a 0 por la izquierda de F de B más H menos F de B sobre H. ¿Ok? ¿Qué es lo que pasa? Que esos límites existen, pero la situación es que el límite, suponte que ahora yo tengo este otro intervalo que va desde C hasta A. ¿Ok? Y aquí, si yo lo calculo por la izquierda y lo calculo por la derecha, bueno, puede ser que no coincidan, existen, pero puede ser que no coincidan. Si llegan a coincidir, entonces la función es derivable en A. ¿Ok? Pero si no coinciden, bueno, no es derivable en ese punto, pero eso no le quita la continuidad. ¿Ok? Está el caso clásico de la función valor absoluto, cuando tú calculas el límite por la izquierda, el límite por la derecha, una expresión como esta, en cero, ¿verdad? No coinciden los límites, pero eso no le quita la continuidad a la función en el punto. Lo que le quita es la derivabilidad. ¿Okay? Pero sigue siendo derivable. Y de hecho la derivada es continua a la derecha de cero y continua a la derecha, a la izquierda y a la derecha de cero. Es una función continua derivable a trozo, digamos. ¿Okay? Pero en el punto este en donde se pica el intervalo, hay un problema de derivabilidad. De continuidad no, porque la función que uno está considerando acá es una función continua, ¿ok? En la definición que estoy tomando acá, es una función continua.
Continua y periódica, ajá.
Sí, ok. Pero bueno, pasa este tipo de cosas. Lo que ocurre es que, claro, la propiedad de ser continuamente diferenciable a trozos, digamos, sigue siendo una buena propiedad, ¿ok? No es un problema de gran tamaño, digamos, ¿ok? Sigue siendo una buena propiedad en términos de, por ejemplo, convergencia, como vamos a ver ahora, o en términos de integrabilidad, sigue siendo una propiedad que es bastante agradable, digamos, ¿ok? A pesar de que pierde algunas cosas, pero bueno.
Sí, profe, Félix, tenía esa duda en los extremos. Muchas gracias.
Ok. Bien. Now, I am going to use this result, the result just proved, in order to prove another more general result. This other result is concerning with the continuous periodic and piecewise continuous differential functions. Okay, well, in this case is it's a similar result to this lemma, okay, but we don't have this hypothesis. The hypothesis, in fact, is a consequence of our hypothesis, our new hypothesis. We have this theorem. Let F from R to C be continuous, periodic, and piecewise continuously differentiable. Then the Fourier series of F converges uniformly to the function. So we have continuity, periodicity, and this new property of continuously differentiable for the function f. Okay. Well, according to the lemma, according to the previous result, if we can prove that the Fourier coefficients satisfy this property, this condition, then the Fourier series of F will converge uniformly to the function F. Okay. So the idea to prove this new result is to see that the Fourier coefficients satisfy the previous condition. In view of the previous lemma, if we can prove the condition, this condition, for the Fourier coefficients of the function f, the conclusion is direct. Is not. So let's prove this condition. Okay. Let me put this condition as star. Let's see star. Since f is continuously differentiable in the interval 0, 1, the definition implies that there are real numbers, okay, so that this function is continuously differentiable. Okay. Let me copy this part. There are real numbers . Okay, there are numbers. Wait a moment. I'm going to close this and open again. Okay. We have some numbers. T sub 0 till T sub r, such that for each function, for each j, j from 1 to r, okay, if j goes from 1 to r, such that this function is continuously differentiable. So let a phi sub j equal to this restriction, or no, not this restriction. The remember that the continuously differentiable property to this restriction means that this function has derivative which are continuous in this interval. So we can define the functions phi sub j from t sub j minus 1 from t sub j to a and to c. These functions can be defined as the continuous derivatives of these restrictions. Okay, let phi sub j be the continuous derivative of this function, of the restriction f restricted to this is j. Okay. This function exists, is continuous because the restriction f restricted to this interval is a continuous function, or is a continuously differentiable function. So its derivative is continuous in this interval. Okay. Now define phi from R to C as the periodic function that for every j coincides with this phi sub j on this interval, the half open interval. T sub j minus 1, T sub j. Okay. This means that okay, we have a new function. Okay, this function is equal to phi sub j when one consider the function phi restricted to this interval. That is, when one consider phi, the new function phi, restricted to this interval, this function is equal to phi sub j. But moreover, this new function is a periodic function. This is a periodic function, which means that when one consider x outside the interval 0, 1, the, for example, x, I don't know, is equal to 1.5, then we have that f of 1.5 is equal to 1.5 of 0.5. Okay, it's a periodic function. The period of this function is 1. Okay, we have this new function which that restricted to the interval t sub j minus 1 t sub j. This restriction is equal to 5 sub j. Consider now gamma sub j or gamma sub k as the Fourier coefficients of this new function phi. Let gamma sub k be the Fourier coefficients of phi. Okay. And then this series is less or equal than the norm of the function phi, the norm to the square. And this norm is phi. Well, first, this is true because of the Bessel's inequality. Okay, let's remember the Bessel's inequality. Here we have the Bessel inequality. Okay. We have a function phi, which is a periodic function. This function is also is continuously differentiable, okay? So this function is integrable. This function phi is an element in this set, okay? So we have that the Bessel's inequality is true in this case, okay? This is true just by the Bessel inequality. Okay, we have a function phi, which is integrable. So Bessel's inequality applies in this case, in this Bessel's inequality. But in this case, of course, the Fourier coefficients are called gamma sub k. And the norm on the right of this inequality is the norm of the function phi. Okay, but note also that this norm is finite. This norm is finite. We have this condition because the function phi is integrable. Remember that we have this norm, the norm of phi, norm squared, is equal to this integral. Okay, but this function, since this function is continuously differentiable in this interval, we have that this function is also integrable. So this integral is fine. Okay. So we have this inequality. On the other hand, note that the integral from t sub j minus 1 to t sub j of this function, note that this is the expression to be considered when one wants to compute the Fourier coefficient, C sub k, the Fourier coefficient of f. Well, it's not exactly this integral because that Fourier coefficient is the integral from 0 to 1. Okay, but this is a part of that integral. It's just the part in the interval t sub j minus 1 t sub j. Well, note that we can use integration by parts. In this case, with f as the function to be derived, we have to take the derivative of f and the integral of the exponential function. When one considers integration by parts in these terms, then one has that this integral can be computed by using this formula. No, here, this is dV and this is V. Okay, so we have a V and this part with this part. No, sorry, this is U. This is U. And this with this is V. Okay. Minus one the integral from T sub j minus 1 to T sub j of the function V times the U. But V is this function, so we can write 1 over minus 2 pi I k times the exponential, okay? And the derivative of this function. Okay. But remember that this phi sub j, let me put this here, is phi sub j is equal to the derivative of this function restricted to the interval t sub j minus 1 t sub j. Okay, so phi sub j is the restriction to this derivative to the interval t sub j minus 1 t sub j. So we can write minus 1 over 2 pi I k f of x times the exponential. Sorry, from t sub j minus 1 to t sub j plus this 1 over 2 pi I k and times the integral from t sub j minus 1 t sub j of this phi sub j. This function, when it's restricted to this interval, is equal to phi sub j. Because we have this equality. This was the definition of phi sub j. Okay. So, in the case when k is not zero, know that in this case, this formula can be performed when k is not zero, okay? Because in the case k equal to zero, we have that this division is not possible, okay? So when k is not zero, when k is not zero, we have that c sub k, which is the integral from 0 to 1 of a of x times the exponential, can be computed as the sum from j equal to 1 to r of these integrals. Okay. And each of these integrals can be computed using this this expression. Okay. So we can write this as the sum from j equal to 1 to r of this expression. But note that we have this k a telescopic sum. Okay, because we have the sum in the first term have minus 1 over 2 pi I k, and here we have f of t sub k times the exponential, in this case, in the case j equal to 1, we have this 1 times the exponential minus f of t sub 2 times the exponential. In the case j equal to 2, we have f plus f of t sub 2 times the exponential minus f of t sub 3. No, t sub 3, no, t sub 3 here. So, okay, here is t sub 2 and then this 1. So, this first is t sub 2. And here is t sub 2, t sub 2, t sub 1, t sub 1. Here is t sub 3, t sub 3, t sub 2, and the exponential minus 2 pi I k t sub 2. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's okay. And so on. J equal to R, F times T sub R times the exponential minus F of T sub R minus 1 times the exponential. Note that this is a telescopic sum, okay? So we have this and this zero, this with the next one and so on. So we have this element minus this element. That in the case of the first term of the sum. In the second case, in the second term, we have the 1 over 2 pi I k times the integral from 0 to 1 of phi of k of phi sub j, no, of phi of x times the exponential. Okay. So we have that Shizuke is equal to this term minus 1/2πik times this term minus this term. Plus 1/2πik this integral. Okay. Remember that t sub r is 1 and t sub 0. Sorry, here is not this one, but this sub zero. Here's this. Let me rewrite this. This is sorry. This sub one minus this sub zero. This is this one, and this is one because it's when j is equal to 1, we have t sub 0 to t sub 1, okay? And t sub 1 also. So here is t sub 2 and this t sub 1. T sub 2, 2, 1, 1. Okay, so this is not t sub 1, but t sub 0, sorry. Okay. Now, this is not T sub R, sub 3, but T sub R. T sub R. Okay, we have now minus 1/2πik times f of 1 times the exponential minus f of 0 times this exponential, which is 1. Okay, plus 1/2πik, and this integral is equal to gamma sub k. Remember that gamma sub k here is the Fourier coefficient of the function phi. But this Fourier coefficient is computed by using this integral. Okay. Finally, note that the function f, remember, that this function f is a periodic function. Okay, you have that f is periodic. So that f of 1 is equal to f of 0. And moreover, this part is also periodic. So this is equal to 1. This exponential is equal to 1. And this function is equal to f of 0 because f is a periodic function. So this part is equal to 0. All this expression is 0. This means that C sub k, the Fourier coefficient of the function f, is equal to 1/2πik. Times the Fourier coefficient of the function phi. Okay. Is this clear? It's okay. Well, finally, note that given two complex numbers, given the complex numbers alpha and beta, necessary, given these two complex numbers, the norm of alpha minus two times this norm, norm of alpha times the norm of beta plus the norm of beta squared is equal to the norm of alpha plus the norm of beta squared. And this is greater or equal than zero. So that we can establish this inequality. The product of these two norms is less or equal than 1/2 times the sum of the square of this norm plus the square of the norm of beta. Okay. We have this inequality in view of the previous argument. Okay. Using this inequality, with alpha equal to 1/2 pi I k and beta equal to gamma sub k, we can write the product of alpha times of norm of alpha, alpha times norm of beta is equal to the norm. Let me write this way. The norm of C sub k in view of this equality will be equal to the norm of this product. It's equal to the norm of 1/2 pi I k times gamma sub k. But this is equal to the norm, the product of these two norms. And this, since this is the product of the norm of alpha and beta, the previous inequality using these two correspondences, we have that we can write this product less or equal than 1/2 times the square norm of alpha. Square norm of alpha is 1/4 pi squared k squared plus the norm of square of beta. This norm is the norm of gamma sub k squared. Okay. Thus, remember our goal. Our goal in this proof is to see that the Fourier coefficients of the function f satisfy this condition, condition star. Okay. We need to see that this series is converged. It's a convergent series. Okay. We know that this series, the series here, we know that this series, the series of gamma sub k, the Fourier coefficients of the function phi, is a convergent series. Okay. And now we see that the norm of C sub k is less or equal than this. So this series of the norm of the Fourier coefficients of F, this series is less or equal than 1/2 the series of this expression. Okay. But we can now separate this series because each of them is a convergent series. This is equal to 1/2 times this series. 1/2, we can write this as follows. As follows. 1/8 pi squared times this series, 1/k² from minus infinity to infinity. This is a convergent series, okay, plus 1/2 times this series. Okay. But Bessel's inequality applied before implies that this series is a convergent series. So we have that this converges and also this converges. That is, this is converging. Okay, so star is to apply dilemma. We have our so. Okay. Voy a recapitular esta demostración. La idea de la demostración es un poco larga, ¿no? Pero la idea no es complicada, sino que se basa en el lema, ¿no? Uno lo que quiere es escribir o establecer la desigualdad asterisco. Esta desigualdad. Si esta desigualdad es cierta, el lema implica que la serie de Fourier va a converger uniformemente a la función f. Okay, entonces nosotros tenemos acá las condiciones son continuidad, periodicidad y continuamente diferenciable. La función es continuamente diferenciable. Entonces la sucesión o la serie de Fourier de f debe converger uniformemente a f. Queremos ver asterisco. Ok. Para lo cual, como esta es una sucesión, o una función, pero continuamente diferenciable, definimos estas funciones que son no más que las restricciones de las derivadas de la función f en los intervalos que tenemos. Okay. Entonces, pues definimos después una función phi periódica cuya restricción al intervalo T sub j menos 1 T sub j coincida con la phi sub j. Simplemente lo que decimos es dentro de ese intervalo tenemos esta función. O sea, la función phi sub j para x en el intervalo T sub j J menos 1 T sub J es igual a phi sub J. Eso es todo, simplemente una definición ya. Entonces vemos que los coeficientes de Fourier de la función phi satisfacen esta propiedad. ¿Okay? Y satisfacen esa propiedad simplemente porque la función phi, siendo una función periódica, además continuamente diferenciable, nosotros vimos que esa función, perdón, es integrable. Y como es integrable, yo creo que por aquí estaba el resultado. ¿Dónde fue que lo vimos? Que esa función, era esto, este resultado es la desigualdad de Bessel. Esa función o los coeficientes de Fourier satisfacen esta desigualdad. Eso es lo que estamos diciendo acá. ¿Okay? Lo que estamos diciendo aquí. Esta es la desigualdad de Bessel, esta parte. Esta otra parte corresponde al hecho de que esta es una función periódica, es integrable, no hay tipo de problemas con ella, pues su norma es finita. ¿Okay? Su norma cuadrado, por supuesto, también lo es. Entonces nos embarcamos, la idea de toda esta cuenta, la idea de esta cuenta y la siguiente es calcular o relacionar los coeficientes de Fourier de la función f con los de la función phi. Entonces, la idea fue usar integración por partes, okay, en el intervalo t sub j menos 1 t sub j, donde derivamos este, integramos este. Integración por partes es bastante sencilla de hacer allí. Se llega a esta expresión, okay, que se obtiene porque esto que está acá es está visto solamente en el intervalo t sub j menos 1 t sub j, que allí esa f' vale phi sub j. Okay. Además, pues cuando quiero calcular c sub k, coeficiente de Fourier de f, calculo la integral de 0 a 1. Y al calcular la integral de 0 a 1, tengo que calcular la suma de todas estas integrales desde j igual 1 hasta r. Okay. Eso es lo que hago acá. Me doy cuenta al hacer la sustitución de esta expresión por la que calculamos recién, que ahí hay una suma telescópica. Esa suma telescópica sobrevive nada más esta parte. Yeah. Okay. Que al recordar que t sub r vale 1 y t sub 0 vale 0, se convierte en esto, pero la función siendo periódica, esto se vuelve 0. Okay. Entonces, queda nada más esta parte. Pero esta parte es 1 sobre 2 pi k por gamma sub k, que es el coeficiente de Fourier de la función phi. Entonces, tenemos esta relación. Finalmente, de esta desigualdad, que es una desigualdad que proviene simplemente de darse cuenta de que esta expresión que se puede escribir, esta expresión es la suma, esta suma al cuadrado, que es mayor o igual que 0. Entonces, usando esa desigualdad con alfa y beta, sí, se obtiene. ¿Okay? Ahora, esto significa que la suma, esta de las módulos de coeficiente de Fourier, de f, es menor o igual que esto, que esta otra suma. Pero estas dos series se pueden separar porque ellas convergen. ¿Okay? Y resulta que entonces esta serie de la izquierda también converge. Y eso es lo que uno necesitaba porque según el lema anterior, si uno tenía esta desigualdad asterisco, esta condición, okay, entonces el lema establecía que bajo esa condición, esa era la condición del lema, teníamos que la serie de Fourier de F convergía uniformemente a F. Y eso termina nuestra demostración. ¿Ok? ¿Está claro esto? Okay, bien, vamos a ese es el último resultado que vamos a ver hoy con respecto a la convergencia de la serie de Fourier. Okay. Y quiero hablar ahora de lo que en el libro se llama Periodic Functions Revisited, ¿no? Es como una revisión, una nueva revisión de lo que son las funciones periódicas. Okay, eso es lo que vamos. Porque la idea de esta sección es entender. Yo había dicho en algún momento, eso está por acá, cuando establecimos esta notación. ¿Sí? R de los reales sobre Z, cuando establecimos esa notación, yo no sé si la establecimos en la clase anterior o en esa clase, o en la clase anterior, acá. Esta era la notación para las continuas y para las integrables R sobre Z. Cuando establecimos esa notación, yo comentaba que en principio parece raro usar esa notación, ¿okay? Pero la verdad es que esa notación tiene mucho sentido, ¿okay? Y ahora vamos a ver que eso es así, que efectivamente esa notación tiene mucho sentido y la razón por la cual esto es así es porque uno puede definir las funciones periódicas usando una relación de equivalencia. Uno puede pensar que allí hay una relación de equivalencia, okay, y esa relación de equivalencia define una clase de equivalencia con las cuales, bueno, que además, vamos a ver, se denotan como R sobre Z, okay, o el conjunto cociente, más bien se denota así. Bueno. Remember that the notation for the periodic functions, continuous periodic functions, for the space of continuous periodic functions and integrable periodic functions es C of R over C. A similar notation is used to denote the space of integrable or Riemann integrable periodic functions. This notation is R of R over C. Over C. Okay, but why to use this notation? Why is natural to use this notation? The idea is behind the following equivalence relation. Okay. In order to answer this question, to give a clear answer to this question, we first define an equivalence relation. or not, we say that X is equivalent or is related with Y. Of course, X and Y are real numbers. Okay. X is related with Y in R and write X related with Y if and only if X minus Y is an integer. Okay. For example, zero is related with one. 1.5 is related with 0.5. 93.2 is related with 0.2. And so on. Okay. Now, here's an exercise. This is an equivalence relation, or proof that this is an equivalence relation. This defines an equivalence relation. Remember that an equivalence relation shows a relation satisfying three properties. The first one is that of a reflexivity, that any element in the set, in this case the set is the real numbers, is related with himself. Okay. If you have X, X is related with X. That is very simple to see. The second property is that of symmetry. That means that if X is related with Y, then Y is related with X. Okay. And finally, the transitivity property. That you, in that case, you have that if X is related with Y and Y is related with C, then X and C are related also. So in this case, it's very simple to see that this relation is actually an equivalence relation. Okay, that is an exercise, and I'm going to use this fact to define the equivalence classes. So we can define the equivalence classes. These equivalence classes are defined, as you probably know, by the set of all elements in the real numbers. In this case, it's in the real numbers because this is the set considered to define the relation. This equivalence class is the set of all elements that are related to X, such that Y is related to X. Okay. Note that this equivalence relation can be thought as follows. You have that two elements in the real numbers are equivalent or are related if they have the same decimal part. Okay, you have two numbers, alpha dot h1, h2, and so on, and beta dot h1, h2, 2, and so on. These two numbers are represented in its decimal form. So these two elements will be related using this relation, the previous defined relation, if they have the same decimal part. So these two elements are related if and only if a sub I is equal, or a sub j is equal to b sub j for each j. So this equivalence relation is just a relation that put all the elements with the same decimal part in the same set. That set is just the equivalence class. Okay. Let me put here a remark. Note that two elements alpha and beta in the real numbers are related, or in this case we can say, because this relation is an equivalence relation, we can say that they are equivalent if and only if they have the same decimal part. Are related. If and only if they have the same decimal part. In other words, if alpha and beta has to form, if alpha and beta has this form, then alpha and beta are related if and only if the decimal part are the same for each case. Okay, that's why these examples are given in this part, because we have the same decimal part for the related elements, or for equivalent elements. Okay, this means that we can represent each real number just using its decimal part. So, the set which is called the quotient set, the set of equivalence classes. Let me write this more detail. The set of equivalent classes or more than the set is usually called the family of equivalence classes. Okay, but family instead of set. The family of equivalent classes, which is known as the quotient set, is denoted by well, in a general setting, when one has an equivalence relational, the quotient set is usually denoted by X over R. Okay, but in this case, the usual notation is X over C, okay? And it's denoted by, in this case, X, the set X is the set of real numbers over Z. Okay, this is the notation used to the set of equivalence classes, or the family of equivalent classes, which is the quotient set. Okay, this family is just the set of all numbers between 0 and 1. This family of equivalent classes can be identified with the interval 0, 1. Why half open? The interval is half open. Well, because 1 and 0 are related. So it's enough to consider only one of them. In this case, I am considering the element 0. Okay. You can, of course, consider 1 and put outside the interval there, 0. Okay. You can consider also the interval 0, 1, enclosing 1. Okay. But it's usually to consider the interval 0, 1, close in 0. Okay. Well, the idea is then that any element in the real numbers can be identified with its decimal part. Okay. So the family of equivalent classes, that is the quotient set, is just the elements that the representatives of these classes are just the elements in the interval 0, 1. Because any element in the real line, it doesn't matter what element you consider in the real numbers, okay, that element always has decimal part. Its decimal part is an element in the interval 0, 1. Okay. So if you have any element, any x in the real numbers, for example, this x is related with 0, well, this is the 0.76, okay? And so this element can be considered as an element in the interval 0, 1. So any element will be related with some element here. It doesn't matter what element you consider in the real numbers could be small or very big or negative, that is not important. That element will be related with some point here in this interval. Okay, so we can consider as the representatives of these equivalent classes only the elements belonging to this interval. Okay. That's the reason why we can give this identification. Okay, we can say that the set, the quotient set of these equivalence relation is satisfying the interval 0, 1. Okay. It can also be identified the quotient set that this quotient set is identified with this interval means that any element in this quotient set let me say this in all form, that this quotient set is identified with this interval means that there is a bijection from this quotient set to the interval 0, 1. So let me give you this bijection. In fact, we can define the bijection. Let me put F from this quotient set to this interval. This interval by F of X is equal to X minus its integral part. This is a bijection. Proof that F is a bijection. Okay. Note that this function, giving any element in the real line, this function maps the element, the equivalence class, which is the equivalence class where is the element x, maps this equivalence class to the decimal part of the number x, because this difference corresponds to the decimal part of the number x. This decimal part is usually denoted. There are some books where you can find the following notation. This is the notation for the decimal part of a real number. This is notation. Let me write this here. Notation. The decimal part of a number x is denoted by, in this way, the parentheses of x. Okay. That is, this expression means that we are taking the element x minus its integer part. Okay. This is, of course, a bijection, okay? And well, it's a simple exercise. I don't want to say any more about this exercise, but it's easy to see that we can identify these two sets, the family or the quotient set and the interval 0, 1, the half open interval 0, 1. As a remark, R over C can be identified and also be identified with with this set, the set which is denoted by T, okay, and some people call this set the unit torus. Okay, this unit torus is a subset of the complex numbers. In fact, consider this function, the function E from the real line to the torus. Given by E of X equal to E to the 2 pi I k x. No, in this case, k is not necessary. 2 pi I x. Okay. This gives a bijection. From the interval 0, 1 to the torus. Okay. Because any element in the torus, this torus is, of course, the circumference with center in 0 and radius 1 in the complex plane. Okay. But some people call it the torus, the unit torus. So this function is a bijection from the interval 0, 1 to the torus, the unit torus. And at the same time, we have the previous function, which is also a bijection from R over C to the interval 0, 1. So it's simple to see that this composition is a bijection from R over C to the torus. So these two sets can be identified as the set R over C and the set the interval 0, 1 can be identified using the previous function. Okay. Okay. So in this quotient set, which is identified with this interval or this torus, okay, we can define the notion of convergence. Okay, and using the notion of convergence, we can of course define the notion of continuity. Okay, before that definition, let me say another thing about this set, this unit torus. Some books, there are some books, let me show you a book in which you can see that the torus is the set in which the functions are defined. Okay. This book, an introduction to harmonic analysis of Katznelson, is a classic book in harmonic analysis, and he prefers to define the Fourier series on the torus. Okay, the torus is the set in which the harmonic analysis is developed in this book. Okay, it's not this. Integral is an integral over the torus, but this integral at the end is the same as the integral between 0 and 1. Okay, it's the same thing, just but it's just denoted in other terms. Why is the same thing? Because this integral is a complex integral, and this if you remember that definition, the definition of the complex integral over a curve, that because this torus is a curve, you can see that this integral is the integral of the function f times an exponential. Well, in this case, is not this is not the case because it's a norm. Okay, but in general, okay, this is the integral over the torus, okay, but there is dx. This dx is a Lebesgue measure. Is a Lebesgue measure corresponding to this expression? No, no, this expression. Well, the idea is that the torus is the set in which the all the concepts are defined. Okay, you can see that is we have in this case Fourier series or trigonometric series, as Katznelson says. Okay, but at the end is the same thing. Okay, just with the other notation, but it's the same thing. Okay. But we say that the sequence of equivalence classes, okay, this sequence let me close this again. So, we say that the sequence of equivalence classes uh, X sub n converges to the equivalence class X. Okay, these equivalence classes, of course, are elements of the quotient set. Okay. In the case of the sequence, and also in the case of the limit. If there are representatives of these equivalence classes, shows that Xn converges to X. Xn prime converges to X prime. Now. Okay, remember that we can identify this set, the set of equivalence classes, that is the quotient set with the interval 0, 1. So in view of this fact, we can define a similar concept of convergence in the interval 0, 1. Okay, it's the same. At the end is the same concept of convergence, okay, just that this new concept could be more easy to understand. In view of the identification given above, the previous concept or the previous definition can be given in an equivalent form in the set in the interval 0, 1. Can be thought on the interval 0, 1. That is, Xn converges X if and only if the sequence Xn in the interval 0, 1 converges to X. Okay. In this interval, or that X is equal to 0 and the sequence Xn decomposes into two subsequences. One of which converges to zero and the other converges to one. Ok. Voy a explicar esto en español. La idea de convergencia en el espacio, en el conjunto cociente, es sencilla. Es simplemente pensar que si uno tiene una sucesión de clases de equivalencia, okay, cada una de estas clases de equivalencia tiene un representante. Okay. Ese representante, lo que suele hacerse en el caso que estamos considerando, es considerar el elemento que está en el intervalo 0,1, cuya parte decimal es la misma que el elemento x sub n. Ustedes recuerdan que esta clase de equivalencia lo que hace es relacionar elementos que tienen misma parte decimal. ¿Okay? Entonces, si yo tengo un xn, una sucesión xn de clases de equivalencia, cada uno de estos xn veo su parte decimal y ese es mi representante de la clase de equivalencia. Okay. Entonces, decir que un conjunto, que una sucesión de clases de equivalencia converge a otra clase de equivalencia, lo que significa es que la sucesión de los representantes, estos representantes que son los elementos que estoy viendo, que son de la forma 0, alguien, okay, que son los que tienen la misma parte decimal, convergen a un elemento X prima, que es un representante, es el representante de esta clase de equivalencia. En otros términos, la situación es que si uno piensa esto, se olvida por un momento de las clases de equivalencia, ¿sí?, de los del conjunto cociente, y piensa nada más en el intervalo 0,1, entonces la convergencia de la que estamos hablando acá es la misma convergencia que la que se tiene en el intervalo 0,1. La única cosa que hay que tener en cuenta es esto último que yo escribo acá, esta última parte de aquí en adelante. Que, ah, no, de aquí en adelante. Y es que cuando uno tiene la sucesión, digamos, converge, si la sucesión converge a una clase que no es la clase del cero, la clase del cero sería aquella clase en la que todos los elementos tienen parte decimal igual a cero. Si uno tiene una sucesión, una sucesión de clases de equivalencia que no converge a la clase del cero, sino que converge a la clase, a otra clase, a una clase cuyo representante tenga parte decimal distinta de cero. Okay. Entonces, convergencia es la misma que se tiene en este intervalo. Uno tiene una sucesión de elementos en el intervalo 0,1 y uno dice que converge a un número dentro de ese mismo intervalo, pues sí. Dado epsilon positivo, existe un delta positivo, tal que un n sub cero natural, tal que a partir de ahí, de ese n sub cero, los elementos de la sucesión se acercan, están suficientemente cerca del límite. Ok, es la definición usual del límite de una sucesión de números. Ahora, en el caso en el que la sucesión de clases de equivalencia converge a la clase del cero, si el límite es la clase del cero, lo que ocurre es que tenemos la situación siguiente. Fíjense. El 1, que si bien no es parte de este intervalo, es un punto límite de ese intervalo. ¿Okay? Y el 0 son elementos de la misma clase. ¿Okay? ¿Esto qué significa? Bueno, lo que significa es que esta sucesión, que puede ser vista, dado que yo puedo ver solamente a sus representantes, que son elementos de este intervalo, okay, puede ser vista como una sucesión acá adentro, si ella converge al cero, a la clase del cero, lo que está significando eso es que o bien la sucesión dentro de este intervalo converge a cero o bien converge a 1. ¿Ok? ¿Por qué? Bueno, porque el 1 y el 0 son ambos elementos de la clase del 0. ¿Ok? Aunque el representante de esa clase es el 0. Uno toma, bueno, en realidad uno puede tomar cualquier representante, pero digamos, el que toma en este caso es el 0. ¿Okay? Entonces, esto significa que esta sucesión de clase de equivalencia que puede ser vista aquí adentro es una sucesión que o bien dentro de este intervalo converge a cero o bien converge a uno. O puede ser que, bueno, haya una combinación allí en donde la sucesión se descompone de dos formas, de dos subsucesiones, una de las cuales converge a cero y la otra converge a uno. En cualquier caso, como el cero y el uno son equivalentes porque tienen la misma parte decimal, entonces en ese caso uno tiene que la sucesión de clase de equivalencia va a converger a la clase del cero. ¿Okay? No, en realidad esto yo debía escribirlo así. Esto es igual a la clase del cero. Pues estamos hablando ahí del cero como clase. ¿Okay? Entonces puede pasar que la sucesión dentro del intervalo 0,1 se descomponga en dos subsucesiones, una de las cuales va para cero y la otra puede ir para uno. O simplemente la sucesión que yo estoy considerando va para uno, o va para cero, para alguno de los dos, y solamente uno de esos. Okay, no. Puede pasar esto también. Esto último, en que se descomponen dos subsucesiones, una que va para un lado y otra que va para el otro, pero lo importante es que el cero y el uno, que son los dos posibles límites de la subsucesión que se obtiene en ese caso, o de la subsucesión que se obtiene en ese caso, son equivalentes. Okay. Now, the notion of convergence gives a notion of continuity. Okay. So, using the notion of convergence in this set, we can define the notion of continuity. The definition, this is not the definition. A function f from R over Z to the complex numbers is said to be continuous at some point x sub zero in this quotient set if for every convergent sequence x sub zero for every convergent sequence, this sequence of course is a sequence of equivalence classes, so it's a sequence here we have that the sequence, the new sequence f of x sub n converges to f of x sub zero. Okay. This is the usual notion of convergence of continuity in the case when this notion is studied in the context of sequences. Okay, remember that a function is continuous in upon x or x of zero if and only if giving any sequence converging to that point, the new sequence f of x of n converges to the point f of x of zero. Okay, that is a well-known result of continuity and sequences. So this is the definition in this case. Okay. Finally, if we define a if we compose a continuous function okay, just another thing before this part. A function f is continuous on this interval. F is said to be continuous on this set, no interval, but set on the quotient set. If it's continuous is continuous at each x in the quotient set. Okay, now if we compose a continuous function on this equation set with the natural projection P from R to C to R over C given by P of X equal to the class of X, we have a continuous periodic function. Okay, let me define the function, this function by f, and we have this continuous periodic function, f composed with p. Okay, and this function goes from R to C. Okay. So we can identify this set, the set C of R over C, the set of all continuous periodic functions defined in the first or second class, okay, with the space of all continuous functions.
Profe, una pregunta. ¿Qué no sería la composición de F con P, con la proyección?
No, sería al revés. Es esto.
No sería al revés, porque la proyección toma.
No, porque fíjate que.
Ay.
Para ver cómo es la cosa acá. A ver si tienes razón. Primero va No, sí, tienes razón. Primero va P y después va F. Lo escribí mal. Sí, es verdad. Ok. Ok, we can identify this set or this space of all continuous functions. This space, not set. With the space of all continuous functions on ours. Ok. Voy a pasar al español y con esto termino. Fíjense, la idea es que uno puede definir. Bueno, ya se terminó la hora. Vamos a hacer una cosa. La próxima clase comienzo mejor con esto si tienen alguna duda, piénsenlo y comenzamos dejando claro qué es esto, ¿no? La idea básicamente es que uno puede pensar o identificar este conjunto que fue el que definimos antes, como el conjunto de las funciones periódicas y continuas en el intervalo en R, ¿okay? Este nuevo espacio de funciones continuas definidas en el conjunto cociente. ¿Ok? Y entonces tiene sentido la notación que usamos antes para este espacio, porque efectivamente pues hay una identificación allí entre este espacio y el espacio de funciones continuas en el conjunto cociente. ¿Ok? Bueno, vamos a dejarlo hasta acá y la próxima clase, si tiene alguna duda, lo podemos aclarar.